Good evening, and a welcome tonight for a beautiful, fantastic, marvelous talk on one of the greatest painters, portrait painters of the Renaissance in Italy. But this is just the background of something that was built around an exhibition of his works. The exhibition was organized by Palazzo Strozzi in Firenze, in Florence, last year. I think you might know that the director is a Canadian. Palazzo Strozzi is run by a Canadian. Isn't that true? And it is the second time that I think for an exhibition they decided to publish some other materials apart from the traditional catalog which accompanies an exhibition. In this case, they decided to devote some attention to the content of the paintings by means of riddles and rhymes. So they had asked Roberto Piumini, who is a very well-known Italian writer for children. I mean, he writes children rhymes, he writes short stories, he runs a program on television devoted to children. So he's really very well-known, and they asked him to create some riddles and rhymes so as people, children, but not only children, can try to better get into the paintings. And this, of course, has been done in Italian, but there is also the audience that doesn't know Italian. So, for that purpose, they've asked Professor Konrad Eisenbichler to turn these rhymes and riddles in English, which is not exactly to translate them. And this is going to be the topic of the talk tonight. So, how Professor Eisenbichler faced this task, this challenge. And I'm sure it's going to be really interesting to learn what his thoughts were and how he translated from one language into another, recreating them most of the time. The book is wonderful. Just to have a look at it, you see it's really great. And this is the famous portrait of Eleonora da Toledo, yes, the wife of Cosimo the First. Look, also the illustrations have been made on purpose. And it goes on in this way. So I think they have done a wonderful work, also from an artistic and editorial point of view. If you have a look at the other side, you find the English version. Our speaker is, I think, well known to most of you. He's a professor of the Center for Reformation and Renaissance Studies at the University of Toronto. He has written a lot on the subject of Renaissance, on many authors and many movements of the period. And he has also translated a lot. Giovanni della Casa, for example, among other things. And he is one of the friends of the Istituto. So when he told me that he had taken the task of doing this, I said, well, we have to present it to the Canadian audience too. So thank you very much for having accepted to give this talk to me.
Thank you so much, Dr. Frisen, Dottoressa Frisen. It's a pleasure to be here And I'm so much looking forward to your reactions to the poems. They are poems that I absolutely loved when I read them in Italian, and I love them even more when I translated them into English. So, I don't know, you'll see from my concluding remarks how vain I've become. Let me just put these things away. I have written up my talk so that I don't go off topic, otherwise we'll be here for 2 hours. I think it's going to be about 50 minutes long, and no more than that. Last year at this institute, I spoke on a collection of children's poetry that the Italian poet Roberto Piumini had composed. The poems were meant to accompany an exhibition of 16th and 17th century tapestries woven for the two Medici queens of France, Catherine de Medici and Marie de Medici. My talk was so well received that Dottoressa Frisella asked me to come back and to do something similar this year. And so I have. This year I'll talk about the poetry that Roberto Piumini and I composed for another exhibition, an exhibition of the paintings by Agnolo Bronzino, probably the best portrait painter of 16th century Florence. Before I do that, however, let me set the scene. Let's start with the location of the exhibition, the Palazzo Strozzi. This is one of the most important architectural monuments in Florence and in Italy today. It is a prime example of 15th century humanist architecture. The palazzo was commissioned by the banker and merchant Filippo Strozzi the Elder, one of the richest men in Italy at that time. The regular cubic form of the building, its enormous size, and the magnificence of its details and decor are a statement not only of Filippo Strozzi's firm humanist ideas, but also a statement of his own sense of importance, not to mention a statement of his obvious economic resources, his political influence, and last but not least, his highly developed and elegant culture. To get the best he possibly could, Filippo commissioned the famed sculptor Benedetto da Maiano to design his home. He then hired the famous architect Simone del Olaiolo, called Il Cronaca, to supervise the construction, which began in 1489 and was completed 15 years later in 1504. The palazzo remained in the Strozzi family for more than four centuries until 1937. And the family sold it for economic reasons. It now belongs to the Republic of Italy. There's a little story behind that. I met the daughter of the man, the Strozzi, who sold it. And she said, he sold it in 1937, but he couldn't do anything with the money because of the war that was about to come up. When he finally was able to do something with the money after the Second World War, the money was sufficient for him to buy a Topolino. The palazzo now houses the Fondazione Strozzi, which mounts several major exhibitions a year, the Italian National Institute for Renaissance Studies, and the Gabinetto Scientifico Letterario Visio, a research center devoted to 19th century Florentine literature and culture. Briefly put, the Palazzo Strozzi is a monument that incorporates within its humanist walls the rich personal, political, artistic and cultural history. Since 2006, the director of the Fondazione Palazzo Strozzi is, as Dottoressa Frisella said, a Canadian, James Bradbury, who was born in Toronto and educated here at the University of Toronto, where he graduated in 1974 with a degree in art. He has had a brilliant international career as an architect, exhibition curator, and museum director in various countries, not only in Canada, but in England, Russia, Germany, and now Italy. A highly cultured man, The one characteristic of his that most fascinated me when I met him was his determination to include in all of his exhibitions something that would reach out to and engage children. Not just one or two items in the exhibition, like tokens for children to play with, but a complete approach to the exhibition that would speak to these younger visitors and accompany them throughout the exhibition, from beginning to end. For the summer 2008 exhibition of French Impressionist paintings, for example, Bradburn had picnic baskets like the one in Manet's Déjeuner sur l'Air, available for children to take along with them as they toured the exhibition. As they went along, a variety of objects in the basket referred to what was depicted in the painting and invited the young viewer to connect the object with its representation. A year later, for the winter of 2008-09, for an exhibition on tapestries woven for the two Medici queens of France, Bradburn asked Italy's leading writer of children's poetry, Roberto Piumini, did I go backwards? Yes, I did. Roberto Piumini, to compose a series of children's poems, that is, filastrocche, that were then published as a small volume by the title L'Occhio Indovino. And these young viewers could then use the volume as they went through the exhibition. Bradburn then asked me to write a similar children's rhyme in English, taking from Piumini, but changing as much as I needed for the needs of translation. The two collections were published simultaneously in a little booklet like you've seen today, with English on one side, and if you turn it around, Italian on the other. Roberto Piumini, the author of these filastrocche, is a multifaceted and very prolific artist. He was born in Edolo, a small town near Brescia, in 1947. A graduate of the University of Milan, he tried his hand at teaching and at acting, but his success as an author led him to devote himself full-time to writing for children. Since 1976, he has published poems, fables, short stories, novels, with an extremely broad spectrum of publishers. He's also composed theatrical works, including musicals. Piumini has collaborated on television shows for children, such as Albero Azzurro, and on radio shows, such as Radicchio. That's a radio show, not a food. And he has translated into Italian over 50 works for children by English authors. Not surprisingly, Piumini has won several prizes. His work, Storie dell'Orizzonte, won him two prizes, the Premio Anderson for Fables, and the Premio Palme d'Oro. His 1991 volume, Tre d'Amore, won the Premio Letterario Piero Chiara. So when I was asked to translate Piumini's filastrocche into English, I was honestly a little intimidated by the thought of translating a much published living author. I'm used to dead authors. But a living author with several literary prizes to his credit. However, I grew a lot more comfortable with Piumini's wonderful sense of humor and lively imagination. And when I was given the liberty to change as much as I wanted, it formed the basis for my own ideas about the poems. But before I tell you about that experience, let me tell you about Agnolo Bronzino and his art. Bronzino was born in Florence in 1503 and died there in 1572. His real name was Agnolo di Cosimo, that is, Agnolo the son of Cosimo, which means that he came from a working class family that did not even have a family name. His father, in fact, was a butcher. The name, or more correctly, the nickname, Bronzino, was given to him later, possibly in reference to his darker skin complexion, but it's not been proven. Having shown a talent for painting, Bronzino was sent to apprentice with some of the best artists in Florence. At that time, The first one was Raffaellino del Garbo, and then the second one was Pontormo, whose portrait Bronzino painted later on. In the 1530s, Bronzino was working on his own, mostly as a portrait painter for the Florentine nobility, producing wonderful works such as his rich portrait of Eleonora di Toledo with her son Giovanni, or the mysterious portrait of Bartolomeo Panciatichi and his wife Lucrezia Panciatichi, the portrait of the young nobleman Ludovico Camponi in a state of sexual arousal, the sensual portrait of Cosimo I as Orpheus, and the charming portrait of the young Giovanni de' Medici with a bird in his hand. Aside from being a painter, Bronzino was also a poet, and one with an especially racy sense of humor. In fact, he was especially well known for his burlesque poetry, replete with double entendres and body wordplays. Bronzino never married, but when his best friend, Cristoforo Alloy, died in 1555, leaving behind a wife and several children, Bronzino took the widow and the orphans into his house and provided for them for the rest of his life. One of Cristoforo's children was a boy named Alessandro Allori, who had a talent for painting and became Bronzino's pupil and eventually his heir, to the point that Alessandro even assumed Bronzino's name, signing his works as Bronzino, and so confusing to no end many generations of art historians. The Bronzino exhibition at Palazzo Strozzi in the fall and winter of 2010-11 was the first, believe it or not, dedicated entirely to the work of this phenomenal artist. It brought together 70 works by Bronzino, that is about 80% of his total artistic production. And it accompanied many of these works with works by his teachers and contemporaries, that is by artists such as Pontormo, Benvenuto Cellini, Il Tribolo, Baccio Baldinelli, Pierino da Vinci, and also the pupil Alessandro Allori. In order to make the exhibition more interesting and much more reachable for the younger viewers, James Bradbury, the director of the Strozzi, commissioned a collection of about 20 children's poems, or filastrocche, from Roberto Piumini and from me. My work was supposed to be a translation or adaptation of Piumini's filastrocche. But since I had to make sure that the verses rhymed and scanned well in English, which is a little bit more difficult to do than in Italian, I was given a free rein to change anything I wanted, and I did. This proved to be great fun. Now, one more prelude. Before I look at some of these poems, let me say a few words about Italian and English poetry. The two languages use two very different systems for writing poetry. Briefly put, Italian counts syllables, English counts feet. And these are two very different things. I'm not talking about human feet, I'm talking about poetic feet. A standard verse in Italian poetry consists of 11 syllables, and it is called an endecasyllable. It comes from the Greek. For example, Dante's Divine Comedy, nel mezzo del cammino di nostra vita, mi ritrovai per una selva oscura, onde la dritta via era smarrita. The standard English verse, on the other hand, is iambic pentameter, that is, a verse consisting of 5 iambic feet. An iambic feet is a combination of 2 syllables. The first syllable unstressed, the second syllable stressed. For example, Romeo's lines. But so, what light through yonder window breaks? It is the east, and Juliet is the sun. Arise, fair sun. Oh, you can read the rest. Italian can vary its verses by reducing the number of syllables, usually from 11 to 7. English can vary its verses by changing the number of feet per verse from 5 to 4 or 3, and by changing the type of foot. That is, instead of using iambic, but soft, but light, through yonder winter breaks, it can use troche, again from Shakespeare, double, double, toil and trouble. Or a dactyl, this is Wordsworth. This is the forest spring needle, the murmuring pines and the hemlocks. Longfellow?
Yes,
Longfellow. Okay, I'll believe you. Longfellow, even my notes say Longfellow, right? Roberto Piumini's filastrocche are all based on an 11-syllable line. Some are also fairly rhythmic in their scansion, but not all of them are. My English renditions use a variety of feet and are, on purpose, very rhythmic. I did this because children's poetry in English is quite rhythmic. One needs only think of Dr. Seuss and his opening verses from The Cat and the Hat. The sun did not shine, it was too wet to play. We sat in the house of that cold, cold wet day. Very rhythmic. And so, let's look at some examples of Piumini's poems inspired by Bronzino's poetry. Let's start with the very first poem in the collection. A poem inspired by Bronzino's painting of St. Michael the Archangel, which is datable to about 1525 to 28, very early in Bronzino's career. Per gioco l'altalena in verità si va su e poi giù alternamente. Ma vedi, c'è qualcosa che non va in questa altalena risplendente. Un angelo la regge con la mano e il piccolo di destra porta su. Chi è quello che in basso, scuro e strano, l'altro a sinistra tiene e tira giù? Forse questa non è un'altalena, e se un angelo salva l'innocente, chi sarà quello con brutta lena che trascina l'altro giù dannatamente? You will note that Piumini uses the 11-syllable verse and its rhyme AB, AB. In my rendition, I use the iambic pentameter, 5 feet of iambic verse, feet. Also rhyme AB, AB. A seesaw, wow, that's lots of fun. You're up and down, you laugh and scream, but look, the seesaw has begun to go off balance. See the beam? An angel holds it in his hand, and on the right, that boy is out. But on the left, a grasping hand has seized the boy that's in that cup. What kind of seesaw could this be? If that's an angel helping out, then who's that figure that I see grabbing the boy that seems to shout? You will notice that the two poems are, in fact, very close. The demands of rhyme and rhythm required a few changes from the Italian original, but nothing really significant. I did introduce the idea that the two children were boys, an idea that is in fact present by implication in Piumini's use of the masculine for the phrase il piccolo di destra. And I did ignore the value-laden concept whereby the right side is good and the left side is bad, present in Piumini's poem when he points out that the boy being saved is by the angel is on the right, il piccolo di destra, and the one being seized by the devil is on the left, il l'altro a sinistra. Aside from this one addition and one subtraction, I should also point out that my rendition is a lot more rhythmic than Piumini's, whose verses do not always run smoothly. I hope he's not watching their live broadcast. For example, Piumini's second verse, have I got the right, did I go back? Piumini's second verse breaks completely from the nice rhythm set up in the first verse, Per il gioco l'altalena in verità si va su, si va giù e poi su alternamente. If one could speak of feet in Italian, one would say that Piumini's first verse is completely iambic. But the second verse is a mixture of two anapests, short, short, long, one iamb, short, long, and one amphibrach, short, long, short. Another example of this more rhythmic pattern in English is evident in my rendition of Piumini's poem on the portrait of a gentleman, sometimes identified as Pier Antonio Bandini. Sì, Pier Antonio, sei affascinante con la tua lunga barba ricciolata, con quello sguardo che vede distante, la tua ampia fronte illuminata. Sì, Pier Antonio, sei molto elegante nella tua seta blu che fa un gioco di arricciamenti, lucida e galleggiante, e sotto quella blusa a rosso fuoco. Bello, elegante, ma non crederai che quella bella donna abbia perduto la sua testa per te? Ma non lo sai che, come amanti, degli dèi ha avuto? You will have noticed that in Piumini's rendition, the rhythm is constantly changing, and at times makes the poem somewhat difficult to read out loud. My rendition instead is much more rhythmic, even obsessively so. Why, yes, Pier Antonio, you're really quite handsome with that long thick beard that comes down in two strands. And let's not forget your brown eyes were the ransom in that ample forehead or milky white hands. Why, yes, Pier Antonio, your elegant nature is clearly revealed by the silk of your coat that shines forth with flashes of deep blue and azure and makes the bright red of your shirt quite a note. You're handsome and stylish, but don't be deceived. That woman did not lose her head over you. Relax then, my friend, and do not be peeved. She's had other lovers, and this is quite true. One of the effects of the much more obsessive rhythm is, I think, the suggestion that the speaker is somehow trying to caress or compliment Pier Antonio. This caressing is rhythmic, repetitive, insistent. In this poem, I was also obliged by the demands of rhyme and rhythm to change some of the meaning of the poem, and especially the punchline. While Piumini, in his final verse, suggests that the lady in question has been loved by various gods, ma non lo sai che come amanti degli dèi ha avuto, I, on the other hand, suggest that she has been loved by other men. She's had other lovers, and this is quite true. This is clearly a cultural reduction. Oh my God. I am assuming that my reader will not recognize the statuette in the background as a Greco-Roman deity, or as an earthly nymph from classical antiquity, but we'll see it simply as a naked woman, possibly with a towel in her hand. Some of the cultural assumptions, and even intellectual assumptions, present in Piumini's poetry can simply not be translated into English. For example, in the poem accompanying Bronzino's painting of the Madonna and Child with St. John, about 1530, also in her report painting, the play on the Latin phrase Agnus Dei and on the Italian word Agnello, meaning lamb, was simply not translatable. I spent days trying to figure it out and gave up. Here is Piumini. Che sia lassù sul colle a bucare sotto la torre e il cielo nuvoloso, o in riva al fiume a destra a belare vicino a quel castello poderoso. O forse è una figura ed è illustrato sul libro che lei legge di traverso. Dov'è l'agnello? Dove si è cacciato? Forse si è nascosto oppure perso. o forse è solamente una parola, scritta dove sono scritte le parole. Anche se qui non siamo in una scuola, lo può scoprire chi leggere vuole. Nice, very nice. In this poem, Piumini is asking his young Italian viewer to seek the land, Agnello, in the painting. Strictly speaking, there is none. So the viewer, the young child, must eventually find the lamb in some other fashion. One way is to locate the lamb in the few letters of script readable on the ribbon held by St. John, Ecce Agni. Which means that Piumini assumes that his reader is able to complete the three letters A-G-N so as to form either the Italian word agnello or the Latin word agnus. The presence of the Latin word ecce adds further linguistic and cultural demands on Piumini's young viewer. Demands which perhaps the young viewer in Italy is able to meet. After all, Latin is taught in Italian schools starting very early, grade 9. I started it in Italian school in prima media, which would be grade 6. It would, however, be totally unrealistic to expect an English-speaking youth to be able to expand the letter A-G-N into anything that might suggest a land. The other way that Piumini's reader may be able to locate the land in the picture is to point to the allegorical land, that is, the little Jesus, who is the Lamb of God. In this case, too, it may be unrealistic to expect an English-speaking youth to be able to seize the meaning and find the lamb in the picture. Italians are mostly Catholic, and therefore would think of the Lamb of God. English-speakings are not necessarily Christian. My rendition of the poem, therefore, takes a completely different approach to the painting and focuses on the script, Ecce Agni, as something completely undecipherable. That was the solution. Had to hear that. Here he goes. John has written something serious on that ribbon in his hands, but the words are so mysterious that just Jesus understands. Mary wonders, what's the language? I don't get it. Is it Greek? Then she adds, oh, I can manage. Here's my book. I'll have a peek. Jesus knows, but will not say it, for those words will mark his fate. If you know, then you must say it. What's the mystery? Tell me straight. For you, the Dantisti in the club, in the group, I want you to notice that like Dante, I rhyme the word Jesus with Jesus. That's what Dante does in the Divine Comedy every time. So I feel I did the same thing. Well, no, he didn't. I didn't rhyme.
Say it.
No, I say it, that's it. I'm blind. By asking my English reading youth to focus on the script on John's ribbon as something that needs deciphering, I'm drawing attention to it. By exposing it as something difficult, as a difficult text, I'm asking for an imaginative interpretation. Then, by introducing Mary as someone who is a bit confused, I make the situation a little bit amusing and also bring it down to earth. Mom does not know what's going on. By drawing attention to the book that Mary is holding, I suggest that the book is a source of information that might explain the text. And I'm suggesting that knowledge can be gained from books, that books can be a tool for deciphering the unknown. In my thinking, then, this array of more mundane references and situations opens the door to a variety of possible conversations between the young viewer at the exhibition and his or her parents or companions. There are other cultural assumptions, or more precisely, political assumptions, present in Piumini's poetry. One of these is a strong anti-war stand, typical of the 1960s and 70s liberal movement, After all, Roberto Piumini is born in 1947, so he's a product of the 60s and the anti-war movement of the 60s. Piumini's poem accompanying Bronzino's painting of the martyrdom of the 10,000, painting datable 1530 as well, begins with a lament, ay, and focuses on the violent and murderous nature of war. Ay, nel cielo che nuvole nere, in terra che violenze, che dolore, colpisce e uccide ogni cavaliere, ogni vittima grida, cade, muore. Ay, persino gli angeli bambini lassù scagliano frecce sulla terra. Che scena piena di duri assassini, di rabbia e vendetta, odio e guerra. Ay, lo vedi in mezzo al furore quello che batte su un tamburo grosso? Lo vedi tu quel pazzo suonatore suonare in mezzo al sangue caldo e rosso? In Piumini's poem, even the little angels in the sky and the drummer boy on earth become participants in this carnage that contains no hope of redemption. Violence, pain, blows, murder, yelling, falling, and death characterize the first quatrain and set the tone for the final phrase, in mezzo al sangue caldo e rosso. In my rendition, I retained the negative overtones in Piumini's poem, perhaps even reinforcing them in my final verse. What black clouds in the sky, dear Lord, what violence here on earth, what pain. The dagger drawn with great discord strikes fast, and soon a man is slain. From heaven, the little angel boys are shooting arrows with great force. This is a scene of death and noise, of anger, hate, and no remorse. And in the midst of all this din, a man plays on his fife and drum. Did you catch sight of him within this crowd of murderers and scum? Though sharing in Piumini's anti-war stand, the English version introduces two important new elements. The first is the concept of no remorse, which may be gratuitous on my part, but does offer a value judgment on the situation, not to mention an easy grind. The other is the idea that the drummer boy, whoops, I went too far. The other is the idea that the drummer boy is a fife and drum musician. There's supposed to be an arrow there. Yeah, there it is. It's a fife and drum musician. In fact, Bronzino's drummer does play a fife while beating on the drum. Piumini overlooks the fife completely. Possibly because a fife player, the tradition of a fife player, is not very strong in Italy. But in the Anglo-American world, the image of the military fife is much more common. And so I wanted to bring it out much more clearly for the young Anglo-American English-speaking visitor at the exhibition. Although Bronzino's fife and drummer is not quite a child, he appears to be somewhat of a teenager. He does offer the young viewer the opportunity to look at and perhaps empathize with the presence of young men in war. The young person's perspective is, in fact, something that Piumini generally assumes and often underlines in his poems. One of the best examples of his child's perspective is the poem accompanying Bronzino's very early portrait of the young Lorenzo Lenzi, a portrait datable to 1527-28. Shown against the green background typical of Bronzino, the young schoolboy is depicted standing, open book at his side, left hand lying on a table, and the boy is staring at the viewer in amazement, perhaps in bewilderment. Piumini asks the boy a series of questions. Chissà perché hai nel volto, Lorenzino, quell'espressione di mesto sconcerto. Sul grosso libro che tieni aperto hai forse letto il tuo triste destino? Quell'espressione di perplessità è perché devi, compito di scuola, leggere tutto il libro. Il tempo vola e tu sei ancora a meno di metà. Oppure accade che tu sia passato davanti a uno specchio a corpo intero e vedendo quel tipo tutto nero all'improvviso ti sei spaventato. Piumini's questions range from a quasi-metaphysical fear of death to a very mundane and childish fear of not being able to finish your homework, to finally the suggestion that the young boy has perhaps been startled by his own reflection in a mirror. In my version, I restructured the poem somewhat, but retained all of Piumini's questions. Why do you look bewildered, Master Lawrence? Why do you stare so strangely into space? There's not a bright young man in all of Florence who's as perturbed as you with that strange face. Did that fine book reveal what fate is keeping hidden for a future still to pass? Or are you scared that time is quickly fleeting and you won't have the book read for your class? Or did you walk by chance, quite unaware, in front of a full mirror in the hall, where suddenly, distracted by the glare, a figure dressed in black stared from the wall? Thank you. I did not mention earlier that the small booklet containing Piumini's poems and my English renditions also contains two sets of images. One series consists of the image painted by Bronzino with our poem next to that image, very much as they appear on the screen like this. The other is a series of full-page images by a young contemporary artist, modern artist in Siena, Niccolò Angeli, that pick up on something about the picture or the poem. For this painting and our poems, Niccolò Angeli focused on Bronzino's magnificent green and on Lorenzo Lenzi's black outfit to create a profound image of a boy's metaphysical questioning, complete with a full moon in the pitch black night sky. Angeli also added a wonderful new insight. The mirror in which the boy sees his image is in fact the book the boy is reading. In Angeli's rendition, the little boy's bewilderment at the world is indicated not by the look of bewilderment in the face of the boy, as was the case in Bronzino's image, but by the very facelessness of the small figure confronting the immense book and the frightening full moon. So I think he did a wonderful job with that one. Another good example of a child's perspective accompanying Bronzino's portrait of Dante Alighieri. Dante is seen holding the open book of his Divine Comedy, turning to look over his left shoulder at the mountain of Purgatory, while with his right hand he points to Florence standing right above the burning pit of hell. See it? Just barely. I'll give you a better image later. Piumini seizes the opportunity to speak to Dante and ask him questions, which is in fact a role reversal. Because if you remember, it's Dante's always asking questions in the Divine Comedy. Piumini's questions seem to come from the lips of a somewhat irreverent child. In testa hai l'alloro della gloria e tieni il tuo gran libro di poesia sotto la destra con triste memoria la tua Firenze da cui andasti via. Dante, per i tuoi bei versi, I need to read my own text. Dante, per i tuoi bei versi, Dante, per i tuoi versi belli e forti, hai il proprio naso, come ben vediamo, e che tu abbia ricevuto torti dai fiorentini, questo lo sappiamo. Ma cos'è quella montagna accesa, quel forno immenso, quell'immensa pira? Che pizza cuoci? Che sorpresa prepari ai fiorentini la tua ira? I thought this irreverent. In my version, I tried to retain this air of childish irreverence present in Piumini's poem by using colloquial playground language that the young person, English speaking, might use. Upon your head you wear the laurel crown, and in your hand you hold your famous book. While at your right, and quite a long way down, stands Florence. Yes, but you don't even look. You have a nose for verses and fine words, at least that's what they told me back in school. And also that the Florentines were nerds who sent you out of town, and that's not cool. But tell me now, what are you looking at? What is that burning hill, that great big fire? Is there a pizza cooking? What's the deal? Or a surprise for Florence, dark and dire? Bronzino's portrait of Eleonora of Toledo and her son Giovanni is still another icon torn apart by Piumini's use of childish perspective. While all scholars over the centuries have focused their analysis of this double portrait on the figure of Eleonora and her extraordinary dress, no one until Piumini seems to have focused on the two-year-old boy, Giovanni, standing at her side. He's born in 1544, the painting is dated 1545, so he's about a year and a half or two, just barely able to stand up. He looks a little bit older though, right?
Yes.
Piumini not only focuses on the boy, but goes a step further and speaks as if in the voice of another boy who is friends with the little Giovanni. Like all young friends, the speaker is chatty. Is chatty, and the young speaker is not held back by any sense of propriety. When he sees something that Giovanni does not see, the young friend is ready to point it out to him, and in this way, to share a secret with him. Che bella mamma hai, piccolo amico, col suo vestito tutto di broccato. Ma io vedo una cosa, e te la dico, ha uno sguardo triste, un po' annoiato. Ha due collane e un ricco pendaglio, perle preziose e orecchini splendenti, però noto una cosa e non mi sbaglio, ha gli occhi malinconici un po' spenti. Allora, piccolo amico, fra poco, dalle la mano e di vieni con me, portala giù in giardino a fare un gioco, a correre e a ridere con te. The idea that the little boy should drag his mother out and get her to laugh and play in the open air is amazingly novel and cheerful. In rendering this idea into English, I very much try to retain that image. You have the prettiest mom around, and yet she seems so strangely sad. The silk and brocade of her gown bring her no joy, and that's too bad. She has two gorgeous strands of pearls, a pair of earrings large and match, a pendant worth of two wealthy earls, and yet she's distant and detached. You need to cheer her up a bit to make her laugh her day away. So take her hand, don't let her sit, and drag her out with you to play. For this double portrait of Eleonora with her son Giovanni, the young Sienese artist Niccolò Angeli went one step further than Piumini or I did. He envisioned the mother and son couple outside in the open air, and then imagined how Eleonora, perhaps tired of wearing her stately gown, had turned the dress into a kite, and that she was now being flown by her son, And now that she was standing next to her son in the open field, wearing only her white undergarments and waving goodbye, so to speak, to courtly stiffness and aloofness represented by the dress. The blue of Bronzino's original background and Eleonora's dress blend in Angeli's image with the open blue skies and the soaring kite. And on the lens and the landscape, which was barely visible in Bronzino's original, has become very clear and very visible, an expanse of land, the garden, suggested by Piumini. And so the iconic image of the Duchess Eleonora, who was known even in her own time for her severe formality and Spanish aloofness, gives way to the image of a carefree, half-undressed mother playing with her son in the open air. The relationship between mother and son has become relaxed, playful, even quotidian. A similar quotidian outcome comes from Piumini's interpretation of yet another iconic image from Bronzino's palette, the portrait of Duke Cosimo I in armor, 1544-45. A portrait exactly contemporaneous with the double portrait of Eleonora with her son Giovanni. In this case, Cosimo I is seen standing in armor, one hand resting on his helmet, his eyes looking away to the right. He has a serious look in his eyes, and his brow is slightly furrowed. Piumini imagines that Cosimo has a serious, faraway look in his eyes because he's a little perplexed. Ti stai chiedendo, Cosimo, perché quando hai abbracciato ieri il tuo amore, nonostante l'affetto che ha per te si è messo a strillare di dolore. Continui a domandarti, corrucciato, perché la tua amata stamattina, quando con tanta gioia tu ti ha abbracciato, ha fatto quello strillo da gallina. Cosimo, lei ti ama, non temere, né credi a noi è diventata pazza. Qualcosa forse è da rivedere per condottiero sulla tua corazza. The idea of the Duchess Eleonora of Toledo screaming like a chicken when embraced by her husband is clearly somewhat irreverent, especially in light of what we know about Eleonora and what we have surmised about her from Bronzino's double portrait. In my rendition, I have very much sought to retain this air of irreverence by underlining the nobility of the ducal couple and then the prosaic nature of their misunderstanding. I was not, however, able to retain the reference to Eleonora screaming like a chicken. Noble Duke, are you wondering why, when you hugged your dear love as you left, she let out unexpected a cry and appeared somewhat hurt and bereft? You are troubled and cannot surmise why this morning your love hugged you tight with great joy in her beautiful eyes and then screamed with such frightening might. Do not fear, she still loves you, great Duke, and don't worry, she has not gone mad. But perhaps from her sudden rebuke, you should think about how you are clad. Niccolò Angeli's modernization of Cosimo's portrait visualizes Eleonora's heart stuck on one of the decorative elements of Cosimo's breastplate, and a flower stuck on the other. The flower may be from Eleonora's dress, or perhaps it's the flower that Cosimo will have to bring to Eleonora when he goes to apologize to her for the way he is clad. The ducal couple, Cosimo de' Medici and Eleonora de Toledo, were famous in their time for the love that held them together. Their contemporaries were utterly astonished that throughout his marriage, Cosimo never took a mistress and never even cheated on Eleonora. And they were surprised also that Cosimo normally preferred to have dinner every night privately at home with his wife and children. Such love and tenderness is not, however, what a prepubescent boy will empathize with, especially when dealing with a girl. The tapestry of Joseph fleeing from Potiphar's wife gives Piumini the opportunity to present poetically a prepubescent boy's dislike of girls. Scappa Giuseppe che ti vuol baciare, accarezzare, stracoccolare, vuole acchiapparti e farti suo tesoro, come quell'altra là che ha preso il toro. Scappa Giuseppe, dalle sue moine o farai presto una gran brutta fine, come il vecchio a destra disgraziato, morto di baci, distrutto, stremato. Scappa dalle sue mani, dalle dita di quella donna che si è invadita, scappa lontano, con le ali ai piedi, nascosto come il cucciolo, lo vedi? In the poem, the fear of prepubescent, I thought I had images of the cucciolo, they're in the English version, okay. In the poem, the fear a prepubescent boy has of prepubescent girls and the possibility of being hugged or, God forbid, kissed by one of them is clearly evident in the anaphora, scappa, scappa, scappa. In my rendition, I kept the anaphora so as to retain the sense of urgency already present in the Italian original, but I also decided to use unrelenting dactyls, long, short, short, in order to give an audible sense of running away from the woman who wants you. That was my prose. And here's the poetry. Run, Joseph, run. Run, Joseph, run, get away from that woman who's eager to kiss you and hold you so close. For if she should catch you, she'll make you her true man, and then you'll be hers from your head to your toes. Run, Joseph, run, get away from her charms, or else you will soon end your life rather bad. Just like the man who collapsed in her arms, or just like the bull that she is hugging quite madly. Run from her arms, from her hands, from her fingers. Run from this woman enamored with you. Flee far away, there is war if you linger, or hide like that puppy. You see him, don't you? Oops. That's my thing, but I went ahead. You're not supposed to see that yet. Okay, there we go. That's right. I must say, I much prefer my version to Piumini's. But perhaps it's just authorial pride on my part. I do think, however, that my use of the anaphora and rhythm works better. And I also think that my diminuendo at verse 9, run from her arms, from her hands, from her fingers, sounds a lot more effective than Piumini's scappa dalle sue mani, dalle dita di questa donna. And so, with my admission of authorial pride, I should perhaps draw my talk to a close before I become unbearably excited about my own verse. I hope my presentation as tonight has brought to your attention not only the wonderful artwork of a painter who is quite probably the best portrait painter in all of Florence in the 16th century, but also the wonderfully charming products these paintings inspired in our contemporaries, in the poet Roberto Piumini, and in the young Sienese artist Niccolò Angeli, not to mention me.
Tonight, art, words, poetry, difficulty in rendering from a language into another, all this has given us what you said in your last words. You said here that the past can communicate to us, and that we can use it to enjoy, to interpret, to give it a new life. And this is really what, you know, we Italians have the great
privilege
of doing. I mean, we cannot help having that. So we cannot really help having this treasure. But I think for us, the good thing is that we don't just want to preserve it, which is either in itself a challenge, but to use it and to bring it to the contemporary world. So, if you have any questions?
Where do we find the book?
In the other room.
There are only copies. 9 copies, so that's all that are
available. Are there any other?
More copies?
Famous painters that could inspire.
I think a wonderful idea would be to do a similar thing with the works of Titian, for example. Some of the very wonderful Renaissance
painters,
and not just Italian.
Piumini is doing anything with any other?
Piumini has not, because he was commissioned, like I was, by James Bradbury to create this, to accompany the exhibition. And that, I think, is a beautiful idea to actually provide. And we could do that with our own artworks here in Canada. You know, take the group of 7 and look at them from a different perspective, from a child's perspective, and see the north in that way. It'd be a wonderful thing to do.
Yeah, it's a wonderful idea to popularize important works from the past with the children, because otherwise they would not be interested in looking at these paintings.
What I found was that when I went to see the exhibition, because I ended up going to see it late, just 2 days before it closed. So I got there to Florence on Friday. I saw the exhibition on Saturday, and they closed it on Sunday. The following Thursday, I was at the Villa Itati, which is the Harvard University Center for Studies of the Renaissance. And there were a number of scholars there at lunch. And they were all coming up to me saying, I read your poetry. I saw the Bronzino exhibit. And what they drew out of the poems was they themselves, as fine art historians, found that Piumini and my poems help them look at the iconic image in a completely new way. Yes. And so it's not just for children. It may have the child's voice and the child's perspective. But like Pasquale, the theory of the Pancerino, it lets you see the world in a new way.
Yes. And there's a lot of integrity that has to be involved here for that translation to occur, if it's going to be really valuable, isn't there? I mean, you have to be really very deeply true to the essence of the thing.
Well, I tried to be as true to it as I could, but sometimes you just cannot translate.
No, I understand
so
what you're saying.
For that poem with the Agnolo's name, I had to figure out, so what is really the point here? And the point is to find to decipher the undecipherable, or to decipher nature. And so to focus on a script that is undecipherable, to push the child to decipher it.
Yes, it's very, you did it very well.
Thank you.
Could
you go back to the screen on this?
On the cake. Okay. Oh, very far. Sorry, went the other way. I had added. How do I do this now?
We need a 5-year
old. Oh, I need the cable to get me started.
It's so easy.
So come fare da qui. We need to redo it there again now. I think we need to check out the mics. No, it's not that one, it's not before. Second. No, you're right. You were right on that. Open. Show. Perfect. Show. I had added a few more poems at the end, but for you, one.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of slides there, Tom. So what they did is for this poem, the very last one, is to try to get the air like that.
Yeah. Yes. It looked like a beach in the ocean.
It could look like a beach at the ocean. It's not very much of a garden.
And also, not very much. As you see from here, there are the lines that can reach the eye. The waves.
It makes it look very early 20th century with the French were doing poetry like that, writing it like that.
Yeah.
Apollinaire, for example.
I find this book really wonderful as a work of art in itself, but not only because of the illustrations, but also how they printed, they underlined the different characters, the words, so that you just focus more on them. Really, very
good. So, any other questions?
Yes.
Have they done something similar with other Renaissance painters or other painters in general?
The previous book that I did 2 years earlier was on the tapestries for the French queens, and it was done the same way. But I don't remember who the young artist was that did the modern version, but it was exactly the same structure. And tapestries, and I did the presentation last year on that, are a little bit harder to read. And so it was trickier, it was a bit more difficult on the visual eye. Whereas Bronzino is very clear, it worked well. That's why I said Titian would be a wonderful person to do it on as well, because Titian's portraits, for example, are very clear.
Very well. So with this, I thank again Professor Eisenbichler.
My pleasure.
For this, and
third book comes out.
Yes, the third book comes out. We will present it here.
Very good. Yeah.